Hey everybody, welcome to Roger and Me, aka Roger Ebert and Me, a Siskel and Ebert tribute movie review podcast in which film critics, myself, Brett Arnold, and Mark Dujsik of markreviewsmovies.com, where we aim to cover every new theatrical release and every new streaming release every Friday in the format that Gene Siskel and Roger Ebert pioneered. Little did they know, they created a whole cottage industry of movie review podcasts all the many, many years ago, starting, I believe, in 1975 with the first iteration of what would become At the Movies. I believe it started as Coming Soon to a Theater Near You. There's a lot of iterations of Siskel and Ebert. We are not an official one. We are a very unofficial one. No affiliation with Roger, with Roger or Gene. We're just big fans and we love movies and we watch all of them every week. And we figured, why not provide the guide aspect, the public service angle of there's all these movies coming out. What is the audience to do with all of them? We have to sort through, you know, I would say about 5 to 10 movies every week. We sort through them all and we let you know what's worth watching and what's not worth watching. This week we have two wide release movies, which I feel like is a lot for this time of the year. We're starting to actually get a lot more movies coming out when there's usually just one big one a week in the first couple months of the year. We've got Kung Fu Panda 4. We've got a horror film called Imaginary from Blumhouse and Lionsgate. There's a new Peter Farrelly, you know, raunchy comedy that's on Amazon Prime called Ricky Stanicky. There's a new Netflix original with Millie Bobby Brown. Netflix made her. And now they're making her do a bunch of weird movies. This one's called Damsel. There's a horror comedy, I guess. I don't know what you'd call this. Kind of a horror movie called Night Shift. And then two indies. One's called American Dreamer. One's called Accidental Texan. Are any of those worth watching? We'll get into it. Mark, what's going on in Dusik's world over there?
I am recovering from a flu. That's why why this show is late, and I apologize. It's the first time we've ever been late for an episode, I think.
Oh wow.
More than a year and a half. I don't think we've ever been late. Now
that's impressive on our part. Perfect attendance. We were bound to miss one. It was gonna happen.
Sorry. Apologies. No worries. It's gonna be 24 hours late and it's all my fault.
Well, I feel no better. Worries.
That's the important thing, I think.
Yeah, you're allowed to be ill, and I'm glad you had a quick recovery. We were able to get this out in 24 hours. Not even, I feel like barely 24 hours later. Not a big deal. Sorry to everyone who had a Friday ritual with the pod.
Yeah,
and that
sorry
we disrupted. That's who you feel bad for.
Yeah, I totally ruined our parasocial relationship with this one.
Yeah, you have to work and get it back. But I think we can do it. All right. What do I have to say up top here? Seven movies, as I mentioned. Mark, I believe, has two more than me on his website, which means he reviewed them in print. I didn't get to them. I'll just be straight up and honest. One of them, everybody said was horrible, and including Mark. So when Mark logged the one-star review of Glitter and Doom, I decided I wasn't going to make time for it. Seems like a bad, cheap indie movie or something. I don't know much about it. You can read about it on markreviewsmovies.com. And Mark also reviewed Cabrini, which he liked. It's the next movie from the director of Sound of Freedom. It's also the next movie from the producers or the studio that made that movie. It's an Angel Studios movie. Is this on its face a faith-based thing?
Yeah,
or is it not? Okay.
It's about a Catholic sister who goes around New York helping Italian immigrants and trying to show people that immigrants are worthy of love and trust and respect.
So it's
and
like
care.
Tonal B-side to
it
Sound
sounds
of
like
Freedom?
A movie that the people who really flocked to Sound of Freedom might not like. It's actually kind of interesting.
That is really interesting. But you know what? As of yesterday night, the cinema score dropped and audiences gave it an A. So Cabrini fans or the people who went to see it seem to enjoy it.
And hopefully some of the people who got there will learn some lessons about the world.
Yeah,
from it.
I didn't mean to not watch it. I will hopefully get to it. I have the screener. I just couldn't make time for it. No offense to that movie. And you know what? There is a pay it forward program for Cabrini, much like there was with Sound of Freedom. So if you want to see Cabrini, you can actually see it for free because of people who went and saw it and then paid for another person to go see it. It's a pay it forward ticket situation that basically only this studio has started doing. And I think we're going to see much more of it. But if you want to see Cabrini, Google, I guess, Cabrini pay it forward and you will find a way to get a free ticket to see it. So there you have it. Let's get into the movies I actually did watch with Kung Fu Panda 4. The last one was in 2016. The first one was from 2008. It's a long-running franchise. Jack Black as Po the Panda. Let's watch the trailer and talk about it.
Time to take the next step on your journey.
I'm not going to be the dragon warrior anymore.
You will advance to spiritual leader of the Valley of Peace.
Inner peace. Inner peace.
Get your surf off my turf!
Dinner, please. Dinner with peas in a sesame soy glaze.
This is not working at all.
Tai Lung, big fan.
Once I possess the kung fu of every master villain, no one will dare question my power.
Yes, that was the voice of Viola Davis as the chameleon, who's really classing up the joint in Kung Fu Panda 4, which I would say, Mark, kind of bears all the markings of a direct-to-video sequel, right down to the A-list cast members that you know from this franchise are now all off on side quests. So here's what they're doing. But we're back here with Po, the only voice who managed to stay over from the original franchise. So right off the bat, it feels a little lesser than the other ones. And this is a franchise that I don't know why I was a 17-year-old in 2008 checking out Kung Fu Panda, but I did, and I very much enjoyed it. And I think I also saw the second one, and I caught up with the third one before watching the fourth one. And this is a franchise that I think is a lot of fun, kind of better than average kids fare, because Jack Black is so likable. It's generally pretty funny, and the fighting style that they use is all very visually pleasing, and they like go above and beyond to make the fights and stuff look interesting. But again, this one does feel a little lesser than, and I still think it's fine and more tolerable than a lot of kids fare. But there's something about this one that we can talk through it. But like, why is the humor here so much lesser than the other ones? And my feeling is that the jokes here all feel canned in a way that the other movies haven't. They feel natural to the world of the movies. In this one, every joke I registered felt like a punch-up job. And I'll give you an example. There's a really great moment where I think Awkwafina plays a fox who's like a thief. And there's wanted posters of the fox all over town. And then she ropes in the panda to her scheme. And within 2 seconds, there's already a wanted poster manually done with panda's face on it. A very funny joke already. But then Kung Fu Panda himself goes, "Wow, I guess city life is fast paced." And the movie is just full of shit like that. And it really weighed it down by the end, even though I thought Viola Davis did a commendable job. And Jack Black is always likable, even when he's reading lines I find annoying. What did you think of this?
That's actually a really good observation that the jokes feel canned, because I think the issue is that all the characters have gone through everything they need to go through already, yes. Which is why we don't have the Furious Five, which is like half the main vocal cast is just gone on their own little adventures.
Yeah, you could say arguably like you said, the movie said all it had to say about them, or the movie did not want to pay Angelina
or
Jolie.
Or they didn't want to come back because they're like, we did everything. What else are we going to do with this material? And I think that's a question that everybody should have asked here. What are we going to do with this material? Yeah. So Poe has already achieved Dragon Warrior status and inner peace and all that stuff. He has nowhere to go. The two fathers already reconciled in the last movie. So what are they going to do? There's nothing for them to do except to go off and have their own little adventure and side quest where they kind of joke around. But again, it's all canned jokes because they don't have that relationship, that conflicting relationship anymore. Poe doesn't have anything to go do, so he needs the new sidekick. And I like Awkwafina. I always like Awkwafina. I think she's funny. She's good here, and the character is interesting. But it's another sort of generic character. I don't want to explain why, but you know, it's the thief who's going to be the sidekick. And there's something revealed about her later. It's like, we know all of this.
Yes.
Everything just feels very generic this time. Even the stuff that's funny, like they go to the tavern. No, they go to the underground sewer where all the criminals of Juniper City live. And they're those three murderous bunnies. They're really cute, but they're also very vicious. Like that.
Yes.
It's a funny joke, but we've seen that joke so many times now.
Yeah.
There's nothing unique or specific to these characters anymore. And I think that's what's lost, is that the material has run through everything it can run through, and now it's just trying to grab at what it can.
Yeah, it's just a case of, I mean, it's diminishing returns on the fourth entry. Like, it makes sense that this one wouldn't be as good as the initial three. It just feels like, yeah, they're like, it's one of those things where these movies make so much goddamn money. Like, there's no reason for them not to throw out another Kung Fu Panda. It's kind of DreamWorks' biggest franchise at this point that's still going. Maybe that's not true. I guess Puss in Boots kind of resurrected Shrek for them. So we'll see where that goes. But it is a big thing for them. It's actually about to gross like $52 million this weekend, which is huge to me. I was actually surprised to see that. So, you know, again, my feeling is this is a lot better than a lot of the kid stuff I watch for the show. I still laughed a few times, but it's hard not to like feel the strain of this one. And even the kids in the screening I was with didn't really laugh at all the jokes. Like, nobody knowing that he's what the Dragon Warrior is when he's trying to, like, you know, throw his weight around and be like, I'm the Dragon Warrior, please let me, you know, get this prisoner away or whatever. And he's like, are my adventures really that regional? Like, that should be an adult, a fun joke for the adults. But again, that canned nature just makes it feel like they were constantly like, hey, writer, get in the room, put a joke in this real quick. We need to spice it up. And that it just doesn't feel organic in a way that the other ones all naturally I was really enjoying. I don't hold any ill will toward it. I just think it's a little lesser than its predecessors. But if you're if you're a fan of the Kung Fu Panda films, I think it's still worth seeing. I just think you should know that something about it's a little off, and it makes sense. It's the fourth outing with the Kung Fu Panda, and arguably these movies are already kind of all pretty samey in terms of the plots of what's going on. They're very minute differences, and the way this one. Did you all, another like straight to video feeling to me is it introduces a villain that I believe was the villain from the first movie, Ian McShane, who comes back to Tai Lung, I guess is his name, comes back from the spirit realm. But like the way the movie starts with his character's introduction or getting pulled out of the spirit realm, and it's just so perfunctory. They don't even like care to set up any story. They're just like, yeah, he's out of the spirit realm now. This guy, you remember him, right? Let's just keep going. So it feels a little lazy, but not bad. Jack Black is delightful. It ends with a Tenacious D cover of a Britney Spears song. So I'm all for this being a gateway to Tenacious D for children, because Tenacious D was a huge part of my life for many years. I love that band. I've seen them in concert. I love Jack Black, Kyle Gass. They're great. 2.5 stars for Kung Fu Panda 4. But check out the song on Spotify.
Yeah, 2.5 stars for me. The song, the cover's great. I didn't realize he had done it. And so when I was sitting there listening to it, I'm like, oh, this is pretty good. They get to sing this. And then some of those Jack Black flourishes started going and the vocal stuff. And I'm like, oh, wait, that's Jack Black. Oh, my God, this is a Tenacious D cover.
Yeah, it's interesting because it's not just a Jack Black cover, a Jack Black song like he did in the Mario movie with Peaches. That's like a Jack Black titled or credited thing. I think that he said in an interview, the director was like, hey, do you want to do a Tenacious D song for the movie? And then they just quickly came to like, what about Baby One More Time? You know, kung fu fighting, hitting, let's just do that joke. And it worked. And I'm assuming they had to buy the rights or whatever, or maybe the movie, I don't know. I don't know how music rights work, but I'm glad it happened. It's really cool that there's a Tenacious D song in a kid's movie. Let's move on.
It's probably not good that that's going to be the big cultural thing that comes out of this, is Jack Black singing Baby One More Time. But
yeah, is the thing people will remember. But you know,
that says everything about the movie.
Yeah, it does. But also, like, what should people remember from Kung Fu Panda 4? Like, I guess it's fine that it's not great. I don't know.
Yeah,
that it doesn't need to be great. I think it's, I just wonder if kids will be as entertained as they are watching the previous ones as they are this one. Because again, I think kids can sense the canned quality too, even if they don't know what's going on. Like, something feels off. Let's talk about Imaginary, a new film from visionary director Jeff Wadlow, who you might know from other Blumhouse horror fare, Fantasy Island, that was him, Truth or Dare, that was him, many, many years before Blumhouse, 2003 maybe, a movie called Cry Wolf, if you remember that. It was like an internet-y serial killer movie, also quite bad. Not a great director, not my favorite. I like to make fun of him on my horror podcast a lot, but how did I feel about his latest, Imaginary? You might be surprised. Here's the trailer.
How does it feel being back?
Good. I had such good memories here. Maybe my happy place can be our happy place. Who left you all alone down here?
It was just my imagination.
I'm playing a new game with Chauncey.
The scavenger hunt list, that's fun.
Chauncey says you're not allowed to play with us.
Oh.
Because you left him. I need something happy.
Something happy? Ugh, that bug freaked you out.
If I can finish my list, Chauncey will take me on a trip to the place he's from.
Something that hurts.
Alice?
Now, let me give you my quick summation before I ask you to go into it. My feeling, Mark, I went in, again, preconceived notions about Jeff Wadlow being a bad director. Didn't think it was going to be any good. And then a few friends had seen it early and told me it's very, very, very bad. So that's where I was going in. So with that expectation level, I really didn't hate this. But I think the third act is such a blatant ripoff of another movie and also just goes on for so fucking long that it really did lose me by the end. And to be clear, it's not just the third act that's a ripoff of another movie. The whole thing could arguably be described as a few other movies, I think. But another big problem with this movie is that it's obvious what's happening from the beginning, and it takes the characters the whole movie to figure it out. And I guess if there's another problem, it's that it's from the Annabelle school of haunted object, where the haunted bear is just kind of there and sitting there and not doing anything most of the time. And this one actually eventually does get to like a haunted bear that's scary. And I wish it leaned into shit like that more, because when it gets to the giant scary bear that seems to be a really cool practical effect monster, I was really into that. And it just it flashes it for like, I would say there's under 90 seconds of screen time for the scary bear and a lot of screen time for the just teddy bear that doesn't look menacing at all. And they try to make it look menacing by just like moving his eyes around or something. I don't know what's going on. But tell me what this movie's about and why you think it's not even as good as I'm saying, which isn't
very good. I don't think it's good at all. So
that's fair. That's fair.
Yeah, I don't think it's good at all. It's just such a generic horror story idea. It's a decent idea that an imaginary friend comes to life, but you're right that we do know exactly what's going on before all the characters do. There's no way that little girl knows where to find that teddy bear unless that thing is real. And right. So I don't know. I'm just watching it. I'm just thinking of all the formulaic stuff that's going on with all of the, you know, all the games that the bear is playing. The most obvious one is the neighbor who is just there to give the backstory and the exposition and the explanation of the imaginary friend. She literally just appears out of nowhere twice.
Mark, It was so out of place that I almost was like, they're subverting a horror trope here, right? Like they're like making fun of the exposition dumping character. But no, this movie's probably just that lazy, because she's like truly just waltzes into the scene like, hey, like let me explain to you what just happened. It's really jarring. You're not wrong about that.
And the second time it doesn't even make any sense. It's just the teenage daughter is walking around at night, and suddenly the
teenage daughter
there. Hey, I got some stuff to tell you. Like, what are you
the teenage daughter who cannot stop referencing Pixar's Inside Out.
That's an old lesson. You never reference a good movie in your bad movie. Never, ever do that.
Let alone, I think, four times they do it. She keeps bringing it back.
Yeah, she keeps bringing up Bing Bong. Like, don't do the most traumatic part of a great movie either.
Yeah.
Oh, Bing Bong. Anyway,
poor Bing Bong.
It's so generic that I could not get behind it at all. And it could have been funny. If that character was played as a joke, I might have been able to get behind it. If the idea of just like the bear being like this cute little teddy bear, but it suddenly rotated its beady eyes like 90 degrees is supposed to look terrifying, like do something with that, I might have gotten behind it. But it is taking itself so seriously, I could not believe they were trying to make that stuff scary.
And could you believe the parallels act. Could you believe the third act parallel to the movie that I'm not going to reference because it would ruin it? If you want to see it,
I think I know exactly what you're talking about.
It's like such a one-to-one comparison. Like there's even a name for the world that they're in at the end, and it's like a parody of the world. Like it's like if you were making a parody of that movie, you would probably call the world that they inhabit this. It is just such a ripoff of that movie that It's very confusing. It also, when I was watching it, did you ever see Drop Dead Fred, that movie about an imaginary friend from like the 80s?
I don't think I have. Yeah. I don't think I've seen that.
But it's basically not a horror version of this. It's just like, what if your imaginary friend from childhood was real and was just kind of like messing up your life? So it's kind of reminded me of that, which is funny. But yeah, I really can't explain why I'm like 2 stars on this versus like 1 or 1.5. To be clear, I'm not recommending this movie, but it was that low expectation maybe that made it. There was like one scene I think worked, the scene where they're playing hide and seek with the bear. And the bear is like, she sees the little bear at the foot of the bed. Like, that made me laugh. But then that scene made me jump. That jump scare was effective. It's such a fucking generic jump scare that I'm surprised it worked. But like, I don't know, it worked. And then I will say there's a, not a subversion, but a twist that happens before that third act that becomes another movie that I thought was actually smart and clever. And I didn't see it coming, even though it arguably is also kind of obvious and predictable.
If it's the one I think you're talking about, is the with the psychiatrist?
Is that how it's revealed? Probably, yeah.
Is it? Because that's kind of useless, that twist, isn't it?
I guess it's useless, but it just made me go, oh, this movie's got like some ideas going on at least. Like, it's not just giving me the basic movie I've seen before. It's trying to do something a little different.
And then it hits you over the head with the montage of like, this is what was actually going on.
That made me laugh again. Why this guy's a horrible director. Like, he can't even do something I like without tripping over himself and being like, do you get it? It's like, yeah, I got it, man. Thank you.
Did you also get it was about trauma?
Yeah, it is about trauma. It is about childhood
trauma. I'm
surprised
you didn't lead in with that.
I should have led with it's about childhood trauma, which Jeff Wadlow has yet to, you know, explore in his films. Yeah, it's not good, but why am I even butting it? I don't know. It's not good. I think I was into the ride of it for a while, like just watching this bear make this girl do bad things. And I don't know, I was hoping it would tie together in a better way. So when it fell apart at the end, I was really just out. But I don't know. I would say this has a slight edge on, like, I think I enjoyed this more than Night Swim, maybe, in terms of Blumhouse movies from this year. I definitely enjoyed it more than the Five Nights at Freddy's. Was that this year? That was last year.
Right at the end of last year, I think.
Yeah. In terms of Blumhouse movies, which are clearly on a downswing, I think this one is a little better than the other bad ones. It's still bad. It's a 2-star movie. I don't know why I'm trying to defend this fucking thing. It's not good. It's not a good movie. It's better than Truth or Dare and Fantasy Island. Do you agree?
I think it's about on par with those. I'm giving it 1.5.
That's fair. Yeah, that character who spews exposition is very funny, though. I wish it were played for laughs and not.
It's
supposed
so
to be real.
I wonder. I do. That performance is so eccentric.
Well,
too.
It's Betty Buckley. She's great.
She is great. But doesn't she feel? She feels like she just walked on set when she shows up. She just feels like oh, we just pulled her in, and she's like, what's going on?
That's another element. What's going on? That's another element of the movie I'm saying it rips off too, I think. Like that type of character, like an older lady character doing what she's doing.
Oh yeah.
It very much is ripping that off too. So, and it's funny that this has 3 credited screenwriters, I think, or maybe even 4. And then like a lot of people that needed to consult to make up this plot that is truly just hodgepodge of other movies, which happens all the time. And, you know, if you're an interesting visual stylist or an interesting director, maybe you could make this thing. In the hands of somebody that's not Jeff Wadlow, this may have been a 2.5-star movie, you know? But in the hands of Jeff Wadlow, it is a 2-star movie. I don't know why I tried to pretend like it was anything better than it is. It's not. It's just better than the 1-star
movie. It's a 1.5-star movie, I think. And I think I'm being generous with it, too, because that third act goes on forever.
Okay, I'm glad you felt that way, too. It has Return of the King level, like, I'm getting out of my seat. And then there's more stuff happening. I couldn't believe it. It was really, really shocking. All right, let's move on to Richard Stanichard, what I've been calling it, full name. I don't know, Ricky. I'm doing the formal Richard Stanichard. But the movie is called Ricky Stanicky, and it's on Amazon Prime. And I'm kind of mad it's not in theaters. I think they should put comedies in theaters. But anyway, here's the trailer for Ricky Stanicky.
Stanicky, what up, man?
Are you serious? Have someone call me when you get out of surgery, all right?
You should drive out there. Ricky's been there for you guys your whole lives.
The devil's in the details, my friend.
It worked.
Atlantic City, here we come.
What we got?
Ricky's cancer's back.
Why does it have to be cancer? Won't everybody get worried?
Yeah, and that's going to take us right into the World Series. Spending all my money in a couple
nights. Going out the college. To Ricky Stanicky,
the best friend we never had. Mm.
My baby's going to be born 6 weeks early.
I was born 6 weeks early.
Oh, I want to know where the hell you guys were tonight. We called every hospital and there was no record of a Ricky Stanicky.
You know, all we did was tell one lie.
Hundreds and hundreds of times over many, many years.
If the truth does come out, my marriage is over.
What if we hire an actor to play Stanicky?
Rock hard rod.
X-rated rock and roll impersonator.
I do a whole act. Wall to wall, top to bottom, jizz jams.
Thanks for coming out tonight, ladies and gentlemen. So horny to be here.
This is a really bad idea.
Oh, Jesus. I've been cold turkey in the booze. Ricky Stanicky's in the program, remember?
Man, let me say up top, I thought this was really funny for a while. I thought the premise is just really perfect. It's a great comedy premise of a group of friends have been pretending to have this guy in their life. He's an imaginary friend in a different way. It's actually funny that this is another imaginary friend movie, but it's not about like a childhood imaginary friend that like helped them through something. It is about a childhood imaginary friend that they conjured to like take the blame for the trouble that they're causing. It's like, oh, it wasn't us, it was this guy. So they've been using this their whole lives. They're now adults and they're still using it to get out of like doing stuff with their wives by pretending that their friend has cancer or whatever. So it's very stupid and outrageous and silly, and I think very prime stuff for a comedy, like a fun wacky caper thing. And like at first, the song parody things, which are all just versions of like, I wish I wrote them down. I don't remember them. But there's like, I watched the movie a month ago. So I don't remember the exact jizz jokes he makes about it's a nice day to jizz again about White Wedding or something. Like, it's really stupid. But I was laughing at the montage of them. And it's truly because John Cena, great performance, great comic performance that helps sell this movie. Like in a way that the material does not. He absolutely elevates the material by being, he's just funny. He sells a lot of dumb shit that shouldn't work. But this movie just becomes so repetitive. And by the end of this movie, Mark, there is not a dick joke this movie doesn't take. If you, however many dick jokes you think there are in this movie, quadruple it and you are closer to the amount of dick jokes there are. You're not there yet. Every joke, by the time they're doing the William H. Macy air thing, I was fully like, this is fucking dumb. Like, this isn't funny anymore. I don't think this is a funny thing. They really wore into the ground. So by the end, I don't know if I can endorse this movie, but man, for a while, this is really funny. And it's in the trailer right there. The fact that Ricky Stanicky's a huge alcoholic and he quits drinking so he can be AA approved and in character as Ricky Stanicky and has to go through these horrible withdrawals. He's never quit drinking before. That's fucking hilarious. It's very funny. And I wish there were more stuff like that and less stuff like William H. Macy can't stop doing air dicks with his hands like that. Maybe, I don't know. Is that, did the air dicks work for you? I've seen some people like the air dicks.
I thought that was funny because the movie started to lost me before that. And so it kind of pulled me back in. It pulled me back in with the air dicks.
Pulled you back in. Oh my God. Oh man. That's really funny. Yeah.
It's a weird movie because it starts off really funny with that prologue and having the kid, just the fact that like nobody questions the fact of Ricky Stanicky. Really?
Yeah.
Nobody. Yeah. It's a funny joke. And it reminds me of like the early Farrelly Brothers stuff that like, you know, like there's something about Mary is so funny in the big gags, but it's also funny in those little details of the characters and how all of the plot comes together and everything. Kingpin's one of my favorite comedies, bar none.
Oh, yeah.
So I was hoping for that kind of return of like these big gags with the little stuff and the little details thrown in. And it starts off that way. And then John Cena comes in like, okay, I am completely behind this movie. And then it just becomes two big set pieces, basically. The first one at the Briss and the second one at the office. Yeah. And that's it. And I don't think the jokes work in those. There's like a lot of setup for a bunch of different jokes, like Cena's character recognizing another actor, them trying to drug somebody, the wrong person getting drugged. There's all these setups. the payoffs don't work. And by the time they got to the office, the workplace comedy stuff, I was out of it. And that's why I said the air dicks pulled me back in, because it's at least funny.
You're right.
And it's Bill Macy doing it. So
yeah, it did lose me before then because of the how far it goes. Like, I'm taking, you know, it does everything you think it's going to do. It goes too far. It tries to be emotional, tries to have emotional backstory that works. And it goes too far of like, our creation spiraled out of control. He's taking over our lives. He's ruining our lives. But it's all played for comedy, but it's all just a little too much, I think. But like, again, you're right. The small details, like the fact that he arrives with not a suitcase, but a trash bag full of stuff that he checked on the plane. That's great. I think he wears a shirt that says, "I don't trust soup, which made me laugh also. What the fuck? It's funny. There's funny stuff in here, but I think at nearly 2 hours, correct me if I'm wrong, this movie's nearly 2 hours. At 2 hours, I think it's hard to like get through the whole thing with, you know, the same feeling you had at the beginning. So it's an affectionate 2.5 for me. I think this is a funny movie that kind of loses its, you know, gets ahead of its skis or whatever at some point. And it's definitely not on par with, if you're familiar with the Farrelly Brothers work, like their comedies are iconic. There's, you know, there's Something About Mary, there's Me, Myself, and Irene, there's Dumb and Dumber, there's Stuck on You, Shallow Hal. There's a million of these movies that like are considered comedy classics. Kingpin, as Mark mentioned. And I've heard people really like that Three Stooges movie that I never saw, but I heard people like it. Did you like that movie?
I did not, but it has one really great, I think it's a salmon farming gag. It's almost worth it for that.
Hey, I love the Osmosis Jones. I forgot that was a Farrelly Brothers movie. That's a great movie. So they have a lot of comedy classics, and I don't think this is up there, but it's nice to see Peter Farrelly doing something like this after winning Best Picture with Green Book, and then doing that Apple movie with also with Zac Efron called The Greatest Beer Run Ever, which really was a nothing movie. So it's, you know, maybe better than you think, and also not as good as the people that like it are saying. So I'm 2.5 on Ricky Stanicky. I didn't hate it.
Yeah, I'm 2 on it, and that's mainly just because, man, I don't think it figures out what direction it wants to go in once it has the gag set up. It's disappointing in that way because, I don't think the friend stuff works as well because those guys needed their comeuppance. That's the whole
point. I don't
like
those guys generally.
Like this.
Yes.
Yeah.
I don't think, and I like Zac Efron as an actor, so I like his character, I think, a little, but like the other two guys, I don't really, well, I guess I know Andrew Santino from other comedies, but Andrew Santino, the redhead, is always playing the same character in everything he does. And I feel bad for him because I think he's a funny comedian that's stuck playing the straight man all the time. And it's really annoying. And then the other guy didn't really get Jermaine Fowler didn't get many laughs for me. And he's a funny guy who's been into other stuff I enjoy. It's underwhelming in a lot of ways, but man, it was for a while. I'm like, is this going to be great? Is this funny? Is this really funny? But you know, I think you'll know whether you like it or not at the first montage of Cena singing dick songs. And if you laugh, keep going. And if you don't, turn it off.
If you're not laughing by the Peter Frampton one, then I mean, it's not for you. Basically,
I wish I wrote
that was
them
the
down
one that so got me. I had to stop. I didn't stop watching. I just had to like stop and laugh for a while when the Peter Frampton one came up.
It's good. There's some fun ones. It's a silly movie. Wish it were better. I also wish this next movie were better. Damsel. Let's talk about this one. Here's the trailer.
I have made a match. The prince. We need this. Your people need you.
I need you to listen to me now. I don't trust them. They may be royalty, but that doesn't make them good people.
Your hand, child.
Close your eyes. I've got you.
This movie literally throws itself into a hole that it can't escape, is what I just realized. Because I think it just, what can you do when the premise is this girl thinks she's doing, you know, like a marriage, a noble marriage to help her family. She's just doing what she should do to help her family not be poor, marrying into this rich family, Prince Charming type of thing. But of course, it's not what it seems. And they're actually using it as a scheme to please this fire-breathing dragon, to give him a sacrifice or whatever. So the whole movie is they throw her in a pit and then she has to survive with the fire-breathing dragon, who can talk, by the way, but says nothing of interest. I found this to be so fucking boring, and then by virtue of the fact that it has just really cheap and bad-looking special effects, it did nothing for me. Like, the spectacle falls flat when every element is clearly fake, especially like very unconvincing CGI fire in your movie with a fire-breathing dragon. On paper, I think it's kind of interesting, though, like what it's doing, like a woman's sacrifice in life made literal. But I don't think there's anywhere for this movie to go. And I think that one big metaphor about women's roles in the world, am I putting that on there, or does the movie even care to have that topic?
No, I think that's the whole point of it. And
okay,
it's,
got it. I wasn't sure. You know, sometimes movies are...
Sometimes it's hard. Like, it's like trauma, yeah. Trauma in imaginary. Is that supposed to... Yeah. Are we supposed to think that? I bought into the premise of this quite a lot. I like the fact that it's a fairy tale, but it turns into a horror movie, like a straight up horror movie.
Maybe it's because I'd read the description first, that it felt like it really took a long time of table setting to get to the premise. But maybe if you weren't expecting that, it was actually a compelling
turn. I wasn't sure where it was going to go. And it is too bad that it does take so long to get there, because you do have to tell people this is what's going on in the movie, is that she's trying to escape a fire-breathing dragon when she's trapped in its lair. Because the build-up to it was really, you know, effective, of like, you get to see this other royal family, and when she goes to that, you know, the ceremony up on the mountain, I'm like, oh yeah, something's gonna go badly here, because they're all dressed like they're in Eyes Wide Shut and everything. But it was, I mean, that stuff worked. The fire, the birds on fire just flocking in, that's like, it was disturbing stuff for, you know, a fairy tale. So I was on board with it, just because it's, you know. But you are unfortunately absolutely correct about the visual effects. And I don't have a problem with the fire. I think the fire was kind of neat, because it's like magma floating around. The dragon doesn't work.
No.
It's really too bad, because they got I had her up. They had Shoro Agadushulu doing the voice. She's got such a great voice. She's a great actress.
Iconic voice that you'll recognize her face when you Google her if you don't know her.
Yeah,
but like,
yeah,
such an iconic voice that reminds me of like Mercedes McCambridge doing the voice in The Exorcist. Just like an instant, like, you recognize that creepiness.
She's great. And so having her do the vocal performance for the dragon is, I was completely on board with having the dragon in the shadows.
Yeah,
that just this terrifying presence that you can't see. As soon as you can see the dragon, though, illusions ruined, and all the scariness and the horror of it just kind of disappeared for me. And it is a problem when you're stuck in one location, that it does become repetitive. It's just her. I mean, because the third act is literally her doing everything that she's already done before. Like, I get it. That means she's improved her skills of survival and all that. But like, yeah, you're not hiding the fact that this plot is just the same thing over and over and over again. And yeah, there's not enough variation, I think, to all the neat set pieces and ideas that it has to pull it off. But I didn't dislike it as much as you, I guess.
Yeah, I just don't think like there's anything for her to do once she's just sitting there trying to figure out how to survive this encounter. Like, it just became boring, especially because, I don't know, maybe if it looked better, I would be like interested. But because it looked so bad, I was just like, I don't care about this. Like, this is almost over. And it was very long. It almost is 2 hours also. Very generous, I think, 2 stars for me from Damsel. It just didn't work.
2.5 for me. I think the performances are fairly good. Like I said, Agadushulu is really good. Millie Bobby Brown is good. You haven't seen her in the Enola Holmes movies, have you?
No, I have not seen that. I haven't really seen her in anything except for the Godzilla movies that she's in, because I don't watch Stranger Things.
Yeah, that
also
doesn't help. But anyway, you should watch the whole Enola Holmes movies, because they're good. They're fun.
Okay, I'll check out Enola Holmes. Yeah. I love when we recommend other movies on the episode with like 7 movies.
It's Millie Bobby Brown and a Netflix thing. You have like a whole bunch of stuff apparently to choose from.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's talk about this next one that we're going to disagree on. Night Shift. Here's the trailer.
It's Gwen, right?
Gwen Taylor.
Teddy Miles. This is my place.
Look, I know it looks as if the damn Adams family used to live here. But trust me, this place is harmless. Really gotta get this thing fixed. Oh, boy. Now, we got 20 cabins. All are basically identical. If you take to the job, then maybe we can make it a regular thing.
That'd be great. What kind of security do you have here?
Security? Well, if you want, there's a fire axe next to the vending machine. Nobody's gonna mess with you if you're swinging that thing around. You know what I'm saying? Welcome to the night shift.
Excuse me. Are you okay?
You know this place is haunted, right?
Now, I'll let you rip into it, but I thought this was really emphasis on the dumb, very dumb fun. Each twist that it takes feels derivative of a different horror movie you've seen before, but I think there's one extra silly layer to it that kicks it up a notch that I'm sure you thought was really dumb and annoying and maybe ruined it for you. But I liked that it kept twisting my expectations of what was happening. But it very much is just a mashup of movies I've seen before. And specifically, this is the movie Last Shift, which was also just remade as Malum, which is someone doing like a new job for the first time in a scary place. But this one's at a motel. So you can say it's like Last Shift by way of Psycho. And I think later on, it even becomes more of a Psycho illusion than you even are thinking it's going to be. So maybe that's why I liked it. It just feels like a movie written by people who like horror movies. And wanted to do their own take on one. And I appreciated that it kept twisting and turning and it kept me guessing. And even though it was kind of dumb, I enjoyed the ride. Now tell me it was dumb and you didn't enjoy the ride. Is that why?
Yeah, it was dumb and I didn't enjoy the ride. I did what you told me.
Fair enough.
No, I didn't. Yeah. I didn't like it because it is just sort of hiding too much. It's hiding way too much.
Yeah, it's very much concealing things from the viewer. Yes,
it has to
manipulate.
The setup is fine. I like this idea of this motel in the middle of nowhere, and you don't know what's going on. And you know, the Phoebe Tonkin plays the character is just wandering around and looking into this hotel, and you know there's gonna be something. There's gonna be something or other, either a physical threat or a supernatural threat, and you're just waiting for it all to happen. And you know, at least the backdrop is interesting. But I think it cheats, even in its own terms. I think there's a couple of scenes that definitely cheat in terms of the supernatural, or at least what you think is the supernatural, if that's the case. However it plays out, because again, we don't know until the very end. There's everything that gets set up, like the whole idea of that room that it only opens from the outside. Like, oh, yeah. You're waiting for the moment when she's going to get trapped in there. And what about the rats? Like, oh, the rats are going to pay off, right? Everything is set up and paid off, except for the big stuff. The big stuff is kept hidden from us for so long that I felt actively cheated. And I didn't appreciate that. So that's where my problem is with the twists of it.
That's fair. Like, I was just along for the ride, but I could see being annoyed by this movie, by what it's doing, because it very much is concealing things. Then it's just like, what about this? And if you're not with it, I could see you throwing up your hands and going, oh, fuck this. I don't care. But I was totally with it. And I think it's kind of like it's well made enough. It looks good enough. It's like I was just in for it. And biggest point for it, I think it's like 80 minutes long. It's very short. It does not overstay its welcome. I think this delivers on an unexpected horror movie that you've never heard of, that if you're a genre fan, I think this ticks all the boxes that it gets a full recommend from me. You know, not like a full-throated 3 stars, but it gets a 3 stars. 3 stars. Very casual.
Wow.
3-star
okay.
Recommend.
I mean,
I want to be, you know, we
you
say
really
all the time.
Love those twists.
Yeah, there's a 3-star spectrum. It goes from like,
yes,
I would like to recommend this cautiously, to I really love this and I think everyone should see it. And I think it's on the lower end of that. But I do think if you're a fan of horror movies, give it a shot. You will have one of two reactions, the one I had or the one Mark had.
Oh, I think it might have worked because there's the whole thing of like the guy in the car too that keeps showing up, and you're like, oh, is that where the threat is? You don't know where the threat is. I think that's the big problem, that it doesn't work as a horror movie up until the end. So you're not sure, like, what am I supposed to be worried about with this character? And that's all I'll say there, I guess.
Yeah, it's just
like,
trying
you don't
to
know.
It's fucking with you. The movie is actively fucking with the audience, for sure.
And I was annoyed by that.
Totally. Totally get it. I totally get it. But I think it was cool. You're 1.5?
Yeah, I'm 1.5 on it. Ooh, so brutal. Big divide here.
Let's talk about this next movie. I think last year we had a strange like festival movie starring Peter Dinklage that was hard to quantify. I believe he was having sex with Marissa Tomei, a tugboat captain in it. I couldn't tell you the name of that movie. Maybe Mark could conjure it up. I'm not sure.
It was She Came to Me.
She Came to Me.
And I only remember that because when I flew to Hawaii, it was not one of the options on the plane. And I'm like, how many people are going to get pulled into this thing?
I would like to imagine you walking down the aisle and everybody's watching. She
that
came
would be
to
hilarious.
Me.
Like
Peter back in the day when
they told me on the tugboat.
Back in the day when they actually showed one movie to the whole plane, it should have been that movie. That would have been so funny. All right, let's talk about American Dreamer. Another pretty weird Peter Dinklage festival movie. Here's the trailer.
I just want a house. I want a place I can call home, Nick. That's the American dream. Four walls, a patch of grass, a place to write my novel.
What are you doing here? Get yourself a starter condo, like reasonable people do who have no money.
$240,000 with live-in. What does that mean?
The house is immaculate. It's worth every penny of the asking price. Her husband passed away years ago. They never had any children.
We live there until she croaks, and I get the whole house.
It's almost too good.
I think this movie, Mark, is so close to being interesting, but it ultimately is a failure of a movie. But I think it's cool, and the premise is interesting in that I think it's a movie about how out of touch, like, the American dream is out of reach for a lot of people. People can't buy houses anymore. And this movie's kind of about that, but it gets lost in bizarre tangents and subplots. And I think that's what loses sight. And that's why it loses sight of what makes it compelling. Like the idea that many will never be able to afford a home and that the American dream is not a thing anymore for most people, that is compelling enough. And then there's like this sitcom-y live-in situation that I don't think is mined enough for comedy. Because basically he finds his house, as you see in the trailer, it's like a $5 million house. But if you live in with this person that lives there now, it's only $240,000. And when they die, it'll be yours. And it does sound too good to be true because, I mean, it basically is too good to be true. And there's all this funny stuff about she acts like she's dying when he's buying the place. And then when he gets the place, she's totally spry and living her life and does not seem like she's anywhere near death. So there's something funny there too, but the movie just, I couldn't even tell you what this movie is actually about. Like it goes off in so many different directions. Doesn't he's dating her, he's having sex with her daughter while maybe pursuing this older woman romantically. He's having these fantasy visions where all the women in the world are pining over him. And it's just interesting. Again, male fantasy stuff, also interesting, but like all in a hodgepodge, it doesn't really amount to much. Am I talking out of my ass or does that make
sense? No, you're not. It's pulling too many ideas and it has a couple of good ones. It has the central one about the American dream and how impossible it is, like in this economy. And then it also has like the whole thing of like Dinklage's character might want Shirley MacLaine's character. Shirley MacLaine plays the owner of the house, by the way, and she's really good, might want her to die. And how do you pull that off? I mean, that's the potential for a dark comedy right there. Is like,
yes, and it skids away from that at every turn, doesn't it?
It does. Oh, it does. And it's too bad because it's funny when it is when he's like under suspicion for trying to murder his
oh god
house
yeah.
owner. It's such like a good, she keeps such a good idea.
She keeps getting into her own like incidents. Like she'll like roll herself into the river on accident. And then of course it looks like he's trying to murder her. So like that stuff,
yeah.
Again, if that was the through line and the movie was like, isn't that a movie already kind of Duplex with Ben Stiller? It's kind of reminded me of that. Where like,
or the Lady Killers even.
Or the Lady Killers. Yeah. Exactly. That's right. Yeah. It's very familiar, but the specifics are good enough where if it ran with it, I think it would have been, again, so close to being an interesting movie, but
yeah,
it gets away from it.
It just is trying to do too many things. It's trying to do the social commentary, and it's trying to do this comedy, and it's trying to do the weird broad sex comedy stuff too, which doesn't work. Like all of Danny Glover's stuff is strange, where he just comes in and like has that long rant about how depraved Dinklage's character is, his sex life is. Like, what is the scene? What is the scene and everything else that's going on here? It's got too many ideas, and without that focal point on anything.
And a CGI woodpecker
that keeps appearing. And it keeps appearing. Yep. It's frustrating because there are so many good ideas, and Dinklage is good, and McClane is charming, obviously. Yes. But like, just pick a lane, man.
Yeah.
Pick
exactly.
a lane and stick to it.
Pick a lane. I totally agree that the performances help make it. Like, there's a line when I think he saves her life. Cause again, everyone thinks that he's killing her, but he keeps saving her life. That's why it's funny, I think. And there's a part where that's why she starts falling for him or whatever. And she's like, every time I see the light, I see your face, because he keeps saving her from death. And he just goes deadpan. It's just because I'm standing over you backlit, because that's what's happening. And the sun's behind him. And it was so funny. I'm like, I want to like this movie so much, because there's clearly the writer's not like an idiot. I think the writers are interesting and have interesting ideas. I think it got away from them, but there's so much potential here that it's not even a cautious recommendation. I don't think it's a good movie, but it's close, and there's some interesting stuff in here. It's a 2.5 for me, kind of an affectionate 2.5.
Okay, 2 stars for me. Yeah, not as affectionate.
Yeah, that one line really made me laugh. I don't know. It's because Dinklage is so good. He just makes that line
good.
Sing.
He is always good. Yeah.
Yeah, he's great.
He could play a guy who looks like he's trying to kill an old lady, but it is actually very affectionate towards her. It's like he's that good. Yeah. He could play those two extremes.
Without him, this movie would be terrible, I think. Without either of these leads, it would be like unwatchable. So
yeah,
there you have it. The congratulations on the casting. They did a really good job.
Yeah.
This next movie is called Accidental Texan. And the one thing I noted from it before we start is that I had never heard of this actor named Ruby Penkow until I watched. There was two movies this week that had this guy in them. Oh, no, you didn't watch the other one.
I did watch the other one. Yeah,
you did not watch 5 Pounds of Pressure.
I didn't get anything about that movie. So
interesting. No, it wasn't.
And
good.
I was and when I saw you log it, I was like, I was not going to ask, like, oh, how'd you find that? Because, I was not up for it.
For some reason, am on like every Lionsgate list possible, and I'm assuming you should be too. But I really get a lot of emails about Lionsgate stuff. So I got a lot of emails about 5 Pounds of Pressure. And I watched it, and it's the most tedious fucking movie of the week. So I'm glad you didn't watch it, and there's nothing to say about it. But other than there's a kid named Ruby Penkow who's in it, and he's also in this movie, Accidental Texan. So when the week started, I'd never heard of this man, and by the end of the week, I'd watched 2 movies with him, and they both were bad. Here is the trailer for Accidental Texan.
Congratulations on your first movie, kiddo.
You gotta turn that thing off before we go hard.
I will.
Okay, so who are we?
On action.
Suddenly Bob kicks in the door, lights the place up.
Yeah, no, I got it.
Okay, people, we got one take of this. Stop messing it up.
Oh!
This movie on Letterboxd is listed as called Chocolate Lizards. It is not called Accidental Texan, but it is called Accidental Texan in the movie and on the poster. So that's what we'll call it. It's based on a book called Chocolate Lizards. I believe chocolate lizards are a type of boot in this movie. Anyway, what the fuck was this movie, Mark? I couldn't make heads or tails of it. I thought it was... This isn't one that I thought was almost interesting. I thought this was who cares the whole time. If you're interested in the minutiae of drilling on Texas oil rigs, maybe this would work for you. But as a layman, I was very bored.
Yeah, you know, Chocolate Lizards actually would have been a appropriate title, because everyone would have, what are they talking about? And then at the end you realize, oh, that's what they're talking about. Because it is very niche in terms of its storytelling and its focus. It is very much about about oil drilling and what you have to do to oil drill, to the point where I didn't understand what was going on in the plot.
Yeah,
because me neither. They don't explain it. They don't bother to explain.
I can't even
why.
Yeah.
Why does this kid need to pretend to be a landman for this oil company owner in Texas?
Because he ran into him. That's why. That seems to
I know. Do all this stuff. Like, why doesn't the oil guy just do it himself? Like, are there some kind of rules and regulations? Like, it doesn't bother to explain, like, why they need to go through this elaborate ruse of this guy who knows nothing about oil drilling, pretending to be an expert in oil drilling, and having to do stuff an expert in oil drilling would have to do in order for the plan to succeed. It's so weird.
It's a very flimsy premise, because even the just the way it's set up initially, with the scene where, like, there's an actor, this guy's an actor, and he's on set, and it's his first job, and the whole scene gets ruined because he refuses to take his phone out of his pocket, but, like, nobody notices, and it's clearly just sitting in his fucking front pocket like this.
Yeah,
it's just the dumbest thing immediately. I'm like, what are you even trying to do here? And then the movie just goes from there, and I was never not confused by this movie.
Yeah, I didn't care so much about that scene's weird, but I didn't care so much about that as much as, like, why are we spending so much time on this stuff? I'm gonna give it a good amount of credit, though. As stupid as the plot is, and as confounding as the plot is,
yeah,
I liked the characters, and I liked the relationship between the kid and Thomas Hayden Church's character. I liked the way that developed. I liked the fact that they have this mutual respect for each other. At least they come to, like, he's not the kid from Harvard, the LA actor. He's not the butt of a bunch of jokes. He's like, you do serve a purpose here. We do need you here. And I don't care about the reason why. The reason is stupid. But the fact that they do need each other, and they do come to rely on each other and come to respect each other, it's like there's a much better movie happening between all the dumb stuff. And I latched onto that. I think I might have latched onto that a bit too much in terms of my rating of the movie. But I think Church is really good. He's like one of the few actors who could just kind of, like, I think he probably just showed up on set and didn't do much, and I bought him all the way as this Texas oil guy. I mean, there's nothing, you know, there's not much to his performance, but he doesn't need to do much. He's just that kind of guy.
Reminded me of him in Killer Joe. It's kind of the same type of character.
Pankow's, he's okay. It's more the two of them, you know, bickering back and forth. And
Bruce Dern shows up.
Yeah, with a prize bull.
Yeah, Carrie Ann Moss is in it for some reason. Yeah, it's just mostly confusing. Like, it's never like, why is this? Like, it just seems like, okay, this actor happened upon this guy, so all of this falls into place, and it just never makes any sense. Maybe the book sets it up better, but the movie is just a mess, and I didn't find it interesting or compelling. I just found it really boring and confusing. So it's kind of a 1.5 star movie for me. I think I really didn't.
I definitely get that. I'm giving it 2. And that feels very, very, I probably should not have given it 2 stars, but I'm giving it 2 stars because I think,
he's good. I get it.
Yeah. And that relationship and the way that it does at least subvert the expectations of, like, this kid's going to get made fun of the whole time, and he's going to learn a big lesson about how big city life is. It's not so much about that. It's about, like, just trying to be yourself or whatever. There's something else going on there. Oh, because the actor has got a problem with his father, and the oil guy lost his son, and so there's that going on between the lines. That part worked for me.
All right.
It's a little cheesy, but it worked for me. So I'm giving it 2 stars just on the strength of that stuff.
I like that you're all doing all that to say 2 stars.
Exactly. It's like you with imaginary. This is my imaginary.
I totally get it. We all have our imaginaries. All right. Well, that was a week. We did it. That was the week of Friday, March 8th. We'll be back next week. I'm trying to think of what the main events are next week. I don't think next week feels like a dead zone. There's a Mark Wahlberg movie that I won't be able to see because of timing. That's about him and a dog. And then everything else sounds
about
fake.
It yet.
Yeah. Okay. Everything else sounds fake.
I'm kind of hoping you get to see it. That's all I'll say.
I'm not, but maybe I will.
I know.
At some point anyway. I still feel burned from Father Stew. I'm mad at Mark Wahlberg.
Because A24 hates Chicago, we will be doing Love Lies Bleeding next week.
Oh yeah, I forgot. Love Lies Bleeding is out now. I liked it. Spoiler alert. It's out now in coastal cities and other places.
We Mark have a coast. We have a coast.
There's a coast in Chicago. It couldn't make it to that coast. But we'll talk about that next
week.
There's
another big one that apparently is not screening at all, so I won't even bring it up, but we'll see what happens with that one. We'll talk off camera.
Yeah, interesting. Yeah. Interesting. What a tease. We'll be back next week. enjoy the musical stylings of Alien Ant Farm until then. Just keep it on repeat until we come back. All right. Bye.
The show starts in one.
Shut up. Ush.